Hello, welcome to Free Bible Commentary with Pastor Teacher Dr. Bob Utley. Be sure to visit Free Bible Commentary at www.freebiblecommentary.org. Now, here's Bob.
I have a favorite account in the Old Testament. We're going to deal with it today. This is the neatest chapter, 2 Kings chapter 6. We're dealing with the life of Elisha, and God continued to manifest him as the successor of Elijah, both in individual instances with the group of the prophets, and also in national instances with the king of Israel. And we're going to pick up an account in chapter 6 that deals first with a rather unusual account that starts in verses 1 through 7. Let's look at it if we could. Now the sons of the prophets said to Elijah. Now there's groups of these prophetic people. They probably all dress alike or look alike, wear that hairy mantle. They're in several different cities we know about. Bethel, Ramah, Gilgal, Jericho. And probably we're in Jericho here because of the closeness to the Jordan River. We're going to get some timbers. Notice it says, "Behold now the place before where you are standing is too limited for us." This is the first Together We Build program. Say, you thought it was something to do. No, they ran out of room. They wanted a brand new place to keep all these preachers in one house. And so they're going to have a building program. They want the chief prophet's approval. He says, sure, go ahead and do it. In verse 3, they say, no, we're not going to do it unless you go with us. Now, friends, that's some kind of building program to get the chief preacher to go and help. I want to tell you for sure. So in verse 3, Elijah says, I'll go with you even. And so they go down to Jordan, cut this timber. Jordan Rift Valley was loaded with timber. It didn't really belong to anybody, so anybody could cut timber there. And so they go down and apparently build this long house for communal living of the prophets somewhere close to Jericho or the Jordan River. Now in verse 5, one of them was falling, a beam. The axe head fell into the water, and he cried out, "Alas, my master, for it was buried." Now, the idea about an axe head, literally in Hebrew, is the word the iron. We learn from Deuteronomy 19:5 that apparently Israel learned iron working in Egypt, the smeltering process they apparently learned, and clear back in Moses' day they had iron implements. Now, this idea of their axe heads coming off their shafts is not something new. For Deuteronomy 19:5 is what happens if you accidentally kill someone if your axe head comes off. And so apparently it was a real problem that occurred over and over. Now the idea here, I think in King James it has, "for it was lent," loaned. This word seems to mean loaned or given. And let me give you a couple of references. Exodus 12, 35 and 36. 1 Samuel 1, 28. Now, I really think it's the idea of borrowed. And that's what upset this man so bad. It was a borrowed axe. He had lost it. Didn't know what to do with it. So he called on Elisha and says, "Help me." And the man of God said, "Where did it fall?" And he showed him the place. He cut off a stick and threw it in there and made the iron float. There's been a lot of conjecture here. Some say that he could see the axe handle, and this stick is something he probed for it, and he caught it in the hole and brought it up. I don't really know what's happening. It seems a rather strange use of God-given powers. Maybe again, at least for the final redactor of this passage, this was to show that Elisha was the successor to Elijah. And this would confirm that to this prophetic group. How he did it, I don't know. The idea about throwing the stick in, the stick floated, reminds one of the ancient concept of imitation. The stick floated, the axe head floated. I don't know what happened. I just know it's a strange little account, and it's going to work well. Now, I'm going to say one word to you I think is important. The purpose of miracles. We live in a day where everybody wants their own personal little miracle. You know, God, give me my own little miracle so I can be certain that you're God, and on and on. Friends, I want to tell you, miraculous is not automatically the sign of God. You ought to see Deuteronomy 13, 1 and 2, Matthew 24, 24, where it talks about that the evil one in the last day is going to be formed signs and wonders. Miracle is not automatically the sign of God. Here, it seems like it's confirming Elisha in his place among the prophets. Now, notice in verse 7 where it says, "And take it out yourself." And he put his hand in and took it out. Apparently, Elijah wanted this man to exercise faith. We don't have the whole account here. It's really presumptuous for us to comment on this when obviously we have just a little account of what happened and don't have all the information. Now, in verse 8 and following, where I think is one of the most wonderful passages in the Word of God about spiritual perception. You know, I think if we just opened our spiritual eyes to what God was doing and wanted to do with us and through us, it would amaze us. And verse 8 down through verse 19 is that kind of a passage. A passage where spiritual perception changes, not the circumstance, but the perception of the circumstance. Let's look. Now the king of Syria, we learn verse 24, his name's Ben-Hadad. But Ben-Hadad is a name like Pharaoh is to Egypt. Ben-Hadad is to Syria. And so it's just the name of the king. We don't know which Ben-Hadad we're talking about. Was warring against Israel. Now probably Jehoram is the king of Israel. He was the second successor to his father Ahab around 849 to 842 BC. That's who we think the king of Israel here is, though it's really not named. And if we can be sure of the king of Israel, we can be sure of which Ben-Hadad it is. Now, and he counseled with his servant, saying, "In such and such a place we shall build my camp." Now, probably this was a kidnap attempt. He was going to send a raiding party to either kill or ambush or try to kidnap the king of Israel when he passed by a normal route. And that's apparently what he's planning here in verse 9. And the king of Israel sent to the place about which the man of God had told him. Notice in verse 9, the man of God, Elisha, tells him, "Do not pass this place, for the Syrians are coming down there." Now, Josephus tells it's a hunting trap. And that's the idea. So the king of Israel sent to this place. Now, probably scouts, not a full army because there's no battle mentioned. He just sent some scouts to see if Elisha was really telling him the truth. And lo and behold, there was the Syrian ambush. And so it was right. Now, this didn't happen once. It happened over and over and over and over again. Look at the last part of verse 10. Now, the heart of the king of Syria was enraged. Now, that's a bit of a strong translation of this Hebrew word. This is used in Jonah chapter 1 for the seed being troubled. Probably troubled, agitated is a better word. Over this thing. And he called his servants and said to them, "Will you tell me which one of us is for the king of Israel?" The only way he could figure it out, why every time he made some plans that the king of Israel knew about it, he said, one of you are a traitor. Well, boy, those servants started hopping around, I want to tell you, and they begin to tell the king what they thought the problem was. Notice, if you would, in verse 12, "And one of his servants, 'No, my lord, O king, but Elisha the prophet who is in Israel tells the king of Israel the words that you speak in your bedchamber or bedroom.'" Now, some think this is Naaman. Well, it may be a Naaman, but I think Naaman was so wonderfully dealt with by Elisha that I don't think he'd say any critical words about this prophet. Maybe he didn't know what the king would do and was just offering information. So possibly it is Naaman from back in chapter 5, where he was so miraculously healed of leprosy by dipping in the Jordan 7 times. Others think it's some other unknown servant of the king, but it is obvious that the reputation of Elisha has spread through the court of Syria. And Syria and Israel have been fighting now for a long time. Ahab got killed fighting with the Syrians over Ramoth-Gilead when Jehoshaphat from Judah and him tried to take it back, and Ahab was killed. So there's been bickering along this border now for years. Now, that about the bedroom here, there was probably no more secure military place in a king's city than in his harem. And this is talking about the inner bedchamber, protected as it was in the area of the harem, a very highly guarded place. And that's his secrets could not be kept. Now, notice in verse 13, "So he said, 'Go and see where he is, that I may send and take him.' And it was told him, saying, 'Behold, he is in Dotham.'" Now, Eusebius tells us, and Eusebius is, of course, a Christian writer from years after the 300s, after Jesus' birth, tells us it's about 12 miles north of Samaria, which is the capital of Israel. Now, you have a map in the back of your Bible. I hope you'll turn there to one of the pictures of Israel and Judah, maybe under David or Solomon or one of those maps. And I want to show you where Dothan is. Notice, if you will, here is the Dead Sea, the Jordan Rift Valley, the Sea of Galilee, and notice right there is Dothan. Here is Samaria, the capital of Israel, and just to the north is Dothan. Now, this was a very unusual town geographically or topologically. It was in a broad valley, but it was located on a little bitty hill. And so what we have here is a city that is going to be surrounded on the outskirts The hills around the city are going to be surrounded, but the town itself is protected by this valley, and it raises up to a little plateau. Let's look at that then. By the way, this is the place that Joseph's brothers sold him into slavery. This is the same town. That caravan going to Egypt, same location. Now in verse 14, and he sent horses and chariots and a great army there, and they came by night and surrounded the city. Now basically what we have here has been some conjecture of what size of army. This seems to be more of a raid, a nightly raid, because we're very close to the capital of Israel. Maybe it was a large force, but not the full army. And they marched all night, and they totally surrounded the ridges around this town. Totally encircled this little village, okay? The Syrian army. Now, when the attendant of the man of God had risen early and gone out. Now, the word attendant here is a different term than is used for Gehazi back in chapter 5, verse 20. Now, it calls him the servant of Elisha. Now, whether these are the same two men, I don't know, because if you know, Gehazi was struck with leprosy at the end of chapter 5 because he took advantage of Naaman and tried to take a reward for Elisha's miraculous dealing with him. Now, whether it's Gehazi or not, I don't know. If it is, the guy's a leper. If it's not, it's a brand new servant. We're just not sure. Anyway, he went out early in the morning and to get water, make coffee. I don't know what they did early back then, but he got the water and he looked up. And completely surrounding that town was the army of Syria. Why, it scared him to death. Well, you can imagine. And so he's going to run back in the house. Look at him. The whole army with horses and chariots was circling the city. And his servant said to him, "Alas, my master, what shall we do?" Now, this man had, I'm sure, a doctrinal faith. He'd been with Elisha. We don't know how long, if it's Gehazi or not. We don't know. He had a mental content about the God of Israel, but he did not have the practical application of God taking care of him on a day-by-day basis. And he was terrified. Friends, it's inappropriate for the people of God to ever be terrified. And here's a good example of someone, I'm sure, who had great faith as far as accurate belief and commitment to Elisha, but just really didn't have that life kind of faith in God. He was terrified. What shall we do? Now, you know, this always tickles me, this whole account. Now think with me for a minute. If the prophet Elisha knew every move the king of Syria made, every time he tried to plan to capture or hurt or attack the nation of Israel, if he knew every geographical location, every detail of that military plan, do you think Elisha didn't know that army was coming after him that night? Isn't that amazing? Ben-Hadad thought he could capture the prophet that knew his every move. Now, isn't that just the pride of man? That may be especially the pride of military man that thinks he can accomplish with might what he can't accomplish any other way. So, I want to tell you what, this is a tremendous example of what men think they can do when they don't take God into the system. Let's look again then. Here they are circling this entire place. The man runs back in and says, "Alas, my master, what shall we do?" Look what Elisha said to him. "Do not fear, for those who are with us are more than those who are with them." I've marked in my Bible 2 Chronicles 32, verses 7 and 8. I want to read it to you. Listen to this. I'm talking about you as much as I'm talking about Elisha. Listen to this in your life. "Be strong and courageous. Do not fear or be dismayed because of the king of Assyria, nor because of the multitude which is with him. For the one who is with us is greater than the one who is with him. For with him is only an arm of flesh, but with us is the Lord our God to help us and fight our battles." Hallelujah, friends. If we could just ever open our spiritual eyes, we would recognize the presence of God all around us. Elijah prays that this, look what he prays, verse 17, Elisha prayed and said, "Oh Lord, I pray, open his eyes that he may see." And the Lord opened the servant's eyes, and he saw, and behold, the mountain was full of the horses and chariots of fire all around Elisha. Now Elijah had seen him before back in chapter 2, verse 11. When the whirlwind came and took Elijah to heaven, it was the chariot of fire and the horses of fire that knocked those two prophets apart. Elijah, that's how Elijah said, if you're to be my successor, you'll see me go to heaven. Elisha could see the spiritual realm. Oh, to God, if we could just recognize His presence with us on a day-by-day basis. Friends, this is not the first time the spiritual realm has startled men who could not see. You might want to see Genesis 21:19. I like the one in Numbers 22:31. That's where Balaam's donkey saw the angel of the Lord before Balaam the prophet did. And finally the Lord opened Balaam's eyes and there was the angel with the sword. Friends, if you and I would just ever open our spiritual eyes, we would see that God has more with us than are with them. I think of 1 John chapter 4, verse 4. I used to watch these scary movies. And inevitably, when I would watch those scary movies, I have to get up and go to the bathroom in the middle of the night. All the way I knew the thing I'd just been watching on TV was hiding in my bedroom. And I'd quote 1 John 4:4, greater is He that's in you than he that's in the world. Friends, we need to realize that. This is a world that has a spiritual element to it, but God's majority is on our side. I want you to notice this. They saw God in a way they expected to see Him. Now, I don't know what I would expect to see God in my day. Tanks of fire, missiles of fire, I don't know. But God revealed Himself to the way that man expected God to be and the way Elisha had seen Him earlier. God sowed the spiritual realm that we see may not be total reality, but it does conform with our expectation of what we think reality is. When Isaiah saw God high and lifted up, he saw Him as an oriental monarch. This man saw God in the military implements of their own day. But I want to tell you what I think it also says. Matthew chapter 18 has often been interpreted as speaking to children, but it's not. It's speaking to new believers. And it says that new believers have their own angels. Friends, I want you to know that I think if you are a follower of Jesus Christ, commit yourself to Him by faith, there is a spiritual realm with you. I believe believers have guardian angels. Now, I don't know why we need guardian angels when we have the indwelling Holy Spirit, but we do. Just read Matthew 18. So here Elisha prayed, they'll open his eyes, and he looked around, and everywhere he saw that Syrian army, he saw the army of God. You see, the title, the Lord of Hosts, Yahweh Sabaoth, is the title, the Captain of the Armies of Heaven. And there the army was, boy, right there with Elisha. And when they came down to him, now apparently the Hebrew here, by the way, before I leave that, this idea of chariots and horses associated with Yahweh is not something unique to the book of 2 Kings. You ought to see Isaiah 66:15 and Habakkuk 3:8 for other examples where God is connected with these horses and chariots of fire. Now, it says they came down to him. Remember the topology of this realm. The army is around the rim of the mountains, but Dothan is down in a valley and then up on a plateau. It's not that the army came to Elisha. Friend, Elisha went to the army. Now, apparently they were moving down into the valley, and Elisha went down from the plateau and met them. And look what's going to happen. Here's this strong Syrian force there to capture him. And look what happens. And Elisha prayed to the Lord and said, strike this people with blindness, I pray. And so God struck them with blindness according to the word of Elisha. You might want to see Genesis 19:11. This wasn't exactly total darkness, but it was confusion to the point that they were disoriented enough that Elisha could lead them in the wrong direction. And so that they were struck blind. And Elisha said to them, not this way, nor this city. Follow me, I'll bring you the man you seek. You know, I've read commentary and say, well, Elisha just lied. Oh, that's so inappropriate for Elisha to lie. Golly, people amaze me. The man of God is doing what God wants him to. He told him to follow him. I don't think you can say, well, this means that we can lie if our lives are in danger. You can't make that application without doing, you can prove anything from the Bible by doing that. Now, so they came to Samaria. Now, Samaria is the capital of the northern 10 tribes. Now, remember, we're talking about the period when the kingdoms are split. 722, the split occurred, okay? And we're talking about when the split has occurred, there is a northern capital of Samaria and a southern capital of Jerusalem. Now, the northern kingdom is called Israel. It's also called Ephraim, that's the largest tribe, and it's also called Samaria. Now, you know, in Jesus' day, this whole area was known as Samaria because of this capital city, the capital of Omri, okay, Ahab's father, Samaria. Now, Notice, if you would, where they came inside the city, and when they had come into Samaria, inside the walled city, all right, Elijah said, "Oh Lord, open the eyes of these men that they may see." Now, they're not going to see the spiritual realm. Friends, they're going to see reality. And reality was, they are right in the middle of the enemy's camp. Oh me, what a place to have your eyes opened. And they saw, and behold, they were in the midst of Samaria, and the king of Israel, Joram, I believe, said, "My father, shall I kill them? Shall I kill them?" You can almost get the intensity of this king. He's almost hopping from one foot to the other. He calls Elisha father, which is highly unusual because they're not friends at all. They have really been enemies through this deal. It shows respect, and that's the title that apparently the leader of this prophetic band was designated father. Now, shall I kill them or slay them, really? This idea of holy war, everybody died. Now, whether that was the concept here or whether Israel always killed their prisoners of war, I don't know. But Elijah says, "No, we're not going to kill them. You're going to feed them." And you can just see old Joram going, "Oh, now what? Put a banquet in front of these men. You feed them well." Well, Joram did it anyway. And then he sent these men back to their own master, Ben-Hadad, and the raid stopped. Friends, there's a lot more we overcome with honey, we overcome with fire. It's a good example of not repaying evil for evil. It's also a tremendous example of the spiritual realm. Oh, you know, I wish that we could just, for once in our eyes, once in our lives, open our eyes. You know that song that, I don't know if you sing it much, "Open my eyes that I may see"? That'd be a good prayer for all of us, you know that? For I think our lives are infiltrated by fear and doubt, and we look to circumstances instead of to God. This is a beautiful account of a man who had head knowledge, a man who knew about God, a man who was serving a prophet, a man who had seen the miracles of Elijah, but just didn't have enough faith to trust God on a day-by-day basis with the circumstance he got himself into. I really believe there's a lot of us like that. We have an understanding of God. We believe there's a spiritual realm. We believe God loves us and going to care for us. But we don't have enough faith to walk day-by-day in complete trust. Now, it's not theoretical atheism. It's just practical atheism. Boy, I want to tell you, I think we need to live in such a way that we recognize the presence of God and the spiritual realm with us every moment. Friends, we do not have to fear anything, for God is with us, and greater is He that's with us than he that's in the world. I don't have to say, but the fact that men saw God as they expected Him to see, I'm not sure we can comprehend the spiritual world, and so many times metaphors are used or analogies. I don't know what the angelic world looks like. Maybe they look like just what we expect until we see them as they are. The Bible depicts them as half animal, half human many times, as being a young man, sometimes as being a military commander. So that it's depicted in so many ways. I don't really know what the spiritual realm looks like, but friends, I want you to know I believe in the spiritual realm. And I believe it's right here with me for good, not for evil. Friends, we need to recognize that there is a real spiritual battle going on. I hope that you have read Ephesians 6, 10 and following. I have a tape I've done on that called "What Spiritual Battle?" I think so many Christians are ignorant of the spiritual realm, ignorant of the purpose of God, ignorant of divine appointments and spiritual opportunities that come their way every day, that if God is ever able to open our eyes, why do you think Jesus kept saying, "To him who has ears, let him hear"? That was the same kind of thing as open his eyes. If we need to be more sensitive to the spiritual presence of the messengers and servants of God, as well as the Holy Spirit being with us. If you could get that from this lesson, if you could put your problems, your needs, your frustrations, your temptations, your trials into this account, I think God will give you a victory. I think that will bless your bippy, I want to tell you. I've enjoyed being with you. I'll see you again, same time, same place next.